I bring you greetings from a part of the world where life is still going on as it did in the Pleistocene. Thousands of animals, millions of animals across the wide open plains. Actually, in the background of that forest is actually where I've had a safari camp, a mobile safari camp, for almost 30 years. So this is still part of the wilderness of Africa. The part of the world that I now call home, and I've been there for over 40 years as a resident of Kenya, is one of the most spectacular on the planet. This is a scene at the Great Rift Valley in Lake Bogoria, where steaming hot pots and fumaroles still bubble over. And it's the home of, as you'll see in the next slide, because of the soda in the lake, home of sometimes over hundreds of thousands of two different species of flamingo, lesser flamingo and greater flamingo. The next picture is some of the other birds that live there. Pink-backed pelicans and among the flamingos feeding on the species that thrive in the plankton water, rich water. These are my friends. These are the animals that I've lived with since the late 70s. I've made 81, and I say this humbly. I don't mean to sound like I'm bragging. It is my privilege to have lived in East Africa, made a living there, done research there, taught there, run a business there. And it's been one of the greatest thrills, one of the greatest privileges of my life to have trekked up to be with the mountain gorillas 81 times over 35 years. So some of the most magnificent creatures in the world. This is Poppy, one of the oldest mothers. Gorillas have babies right through their lifetime. And Poppy was the one of the oldest to give birth. These are just friends of mine. I actually took this a few months ago. And I actually was giving a lecture at the Explorers Club in New York 1 month ago. Thanks. Next slide. So I just thought I'd put some faces of Africa in front of you to remind you of the spectacle and the magnificent world. These are all my own photographs that I've taken right literally in my backyard. So obviously, this is a part of the world where wildlife still thrive, but it's a fragile existence. And I'm going to talk about what's happening and what we need to do, what's being done, and hopefully can be done in the next 20 minutes or so. So the company I own, I bought in 1999. I started proceedings to buy a company called Newland Tarlton and Company. It had originally been incorporated in British East Africa in 1904. And the two men who started the company were Victor Mara Newland and Leslie Tarlton. Both men were recently soldiers in the Australian contingent in the Boer War, had had enough of the war. When it ended, instead of going back to Australia, they took a tramp steamer, certainly Victor Mara did, back up to East Africa just to see a bit of that world. And while there, founded a company that I'm happy to say I've rebuilt and is now proudly taking its place as a pioneering safari company, still sticking close to the goals of the original company. So the next few shots are a little bit of history of Newland Tarlton and Company. The four men you see there are the principals when the company first started, seated with the white hat and the white shoes, very actually nicely dressed up. That's Victor Mara Newland from here in Adelaide. And next to him is his business partner, Leslie Tarlton. And Victor Mara Newland lived in East Africa from 1904, effectively, until 1923. He then left East Africa for health reasons. He actually was active in the First World War, which was hell, as we all know. And so his health was very badly impaired. So he came back to Adelaide and founded a great practice and became a member of parliament for North Adelaide and served with great distinction in this community till 1953 when he passed away. And I was very honored to be able to visit, thanks to Nicholas and Suzanne, to visit Victor Mara Newland and his wife Elsie's graves at Victor Harbor. The two men standing are the head guides. On your left, as you look at the screen, is R.J. Cunningham, who is the beginner of it all. He was the icon of all safari guides. Equally amazing on the right, as you look at it, is Alan Black. Both men were scientists before their times. They were responsible for discoveries of many new species, and they brought Newland Tarleton's, Victor Mara Newland was actually the logistics guy. He was the marketing man. He organized all the office stuff and handled what we call the back office work. Leslie Tarleton was actually a great rifle shot, knew all about handling the safari in the field, and was the day-to-day manager actually in the bush. And the two guides took the clients out. I wanted to talk about, this is a picture I actually just got last night from Nicholas. This is from the Nicholas Father's album. That's Victor Mara Newland as he's leaving in 1900, right here in Adelaide, shipping out with the Australian contingent that had a very rough voyage out to Natal, South Africa. And I've been reading his memoirs, and I'm telling you what those young men went through and what they did to serve their empire, and later in 1901 to serve the Federation and the Commonwealth, is so admirable. It's a tribute to these young men that went to war. But they suffered. And the psychological damage of his great friend, Breaker Morant, Harry Morant, was executed by the British, and he was present at the execution. That and the terrible toll of the war itself made him feel like he couldn't go back to Adelaide just then, and he shipped up to Mombasa, took the train up to what was then just a little trading village called Nairobi, and founded a great luxury brand. So the next photograph is, as soon as they put some money together, they actually got a loan of £500 from Victor Mara's father, Simpson Newland, and bought some property and built a corrugated tin building, which was the Newland Tarleton and Company headquarters. They trained staff, they put the whole thing together. They invented what's now considered luxury tented safaris, famous around the world. That is what East Africa is known for. Newland Tarleton and Company invented that concept. And their first big year was 1906. The next photograph shows the list of, well, that's their letterhead when they first incorporated, which I've rescued. And now this is, if we freeze it here, this is all the clients they had in 1906. And it's really interesting to me to read Victor Mara Newland's comments about the different clients. The Duke of Connaught was Queen Victoria's youngest son. He came out in 1906 to inaugurate what's now called, it was then called Victoria Park in Nairobi, still a city park. Earl Cowley, I've actually gone to meet the Marquess of Waterford's grandson, the eighth Marquess of Waterford, and talk about his grandfather's safari and actually help sort out some of the collections that were made. Colonel Patterson, of course, was the man who shot the man-eaters of Savo, and he went on safari in 1906 and 7, which is a very famous story, which I would love to tell you about. At the very bottom, C.E. Ackley. Carl Ackley was a member, one of the founding members of the Explorers Club of New York, which I'm proud to be a member of, and he was actually the founder of the idea of realistic taxidermy wildlife displays in museums. Field Museum and the American Museum of Natural History are his work, and so on. Abel Chapman on the right corner, on the right column. Shaw Kennedy, Holmes Tarn was from the British Museum. These are all very, very prestigious safaris, and it put Newland and Tarleton squarely on the map. And the most important thing it did is it took the Swahili word safari and made it known to the rest of the world as a luxury adventure that was now had the romantic cachet. So Newland and Tarleton's great achievement was in 1909, President Theodore Roosevelt had decided to resign his presidency, having served only 6 years. As you may remember, President Roosevelt was vice president to William McKinley, who was assassinated. After 2 years in office, Roosevelt went from being undersecretary of the Navy and a very little known vice president to suddenly being the most powerful man on the planet and had the most successful re-election for the next 4 years, could have easily stayed in the White House, but he wanted to go to Africa. He was tired of politics, tired of Washington, and he just refused to accept anybody else telling him he could run another term, and he tied up everything and left, and he went on safari with Newland Tarlton and Company and spent the year 1909 on safari. That's the gentlemen that are in the foreground. The man with the square top hat and the full beard is R.J. Cunningham. The man who's standing with the hands on his hips and the big dome top hat with the feathers in it, that's Leslie Tarlton. And that's breaking camp and the porters putting the loads and carrying them off on the Roosevelt safari. So the next picture I thought was really interesting. It shows Theodore Roosevelt with Alan Black and a couple members of his group on the African plains. Roosevelt's group was about 20 individuals from the Smithsonian, his own family, his son Kermit. Most people don't realize, and there were 300 African porters, all managed by Victor Mara Newland. By the way, Victor Mara Newland, when Roosevelt arrived, had gone back to Australia. He'd been summoned by a very, very beautiful Adelaide girl called Elsie, who basically sent him about a four-word or five-line telegram, "Please come to me." And it meant, "Get your back to Adelaide, or I'm gone." So he went back to Adelaide, married Elsie, and brought her home to Kenya. She was already pregnant by the time she arrived as a young bride, never having set foot in Africa, and they had their two daughters born in East Africa and raised them in parklands and with Thega. So Victor Mara Newland actually wasn't there to greet Roosevelt, but he took over the handling of the trip from the ground, and Leslie Tarlton was guiding the trip. So this we found, this just happened last week, thanks to Philip Jones at our museum. We have the correspondence for Newland Tarlton and Company with our own Australian, South Australian museum here in Adelaide. And the hippopotamus that's in the Africa display, if you go into the mammal hall of the museum, was sent to the museum in 1909 by Newland and Tarlton. And the hippo is there to this day. And you can see that letter and also the Newland Tarlton and Company heading, which was a thrill for me to see. So the modern Newland Tarlton and Company I bought, it was still on the registry of companies in Nairobi. I'd been doing research about history of safari, obviously knew all about the history and Victor Mara Newland's name, but never knew anything about the family and the story. And I run vintage tented camp safaris in the style of Newland and Tarlton and the Roosevelt Expedition. In fact, some of you may have seen a BBC special. I've heard reference of it a few times here since I've arrived. It was Richard E. Grant doing a BBC history of safari. That's me. When they do the Roosevelt safari, that's the younger me. It was made several years ago. So that's me in my Land Rover. And the next couple of shots show what the modern Newland Tarlton company looks like. My background is I came out to East Africa to do my PhD research. I was at the Leakey Institute of African Prehistory. I was doing a double research project. One was I'm a field archaeologist in the area of forensic osteology. So I'm, okay, that's my office. That's how I go to work every morning. And you can see the Newland Tarlton and Company tire covers in the back. And the next shot shows my neighborhood. That's forest. The Maasai took me about 30 years ago to the forest and said, this corner of the forest, we'd like you to have, this is part of their Maasai family holdings. And I've been there, and my camp is immobile. There's nothing there right now, it's just forest. So when the safari season starts and I've got guests, we bring all the tents, all the equipment out, and set it up just the way they did for the Roosevelt safari, except we've got flush toilets, lots of ice, great wine, Persian carpets, four-poster beds, etc. Next couple of shots, next picture, shows the modern version of Adelaide's own Newland and Tarlton on safari in Africa. I just took those pictures in September. Also, this was in September. I did a fashion shoot for a couple of fashion companies, do safari clothes and coats. They're kind of the R.M. Williams of America. This is my lounge, and it's mobile. You're greeted when you come in for the evening. I designed the tents myself. I've made all the tents in my backyard in Nairobi. All the furniture is my own personal furniture that I've designed and had made for me. And all the books and all the antiques belong to me. So it's really home. So you're coming to stay in my home. We dine by candlelight every night. We use solar-powered electricity. But this is a shot showing the lounge again, just some of the details. The American flag is hanging there for a reason. Of course, the Roosevelt Safari was in 1909. The flag they used was the flag that only had 48 stars on it. So I actually had the Roosevelt flag copied, and we hang Roosevelt's flag in the lounge behind the bar. You know when dinner's ready, when the lights, candles are being lighted, and we shut out the lights, and every night dine by candlelight. Our chef, I've had several chefs over the years, but my chef for the last 20 years is John Matungi. We bring in flowers from Nairobi and dress the tables up with antiques, and dining for any of the meals is always meant to be an adventure as beautiful as safari itself. I designed the tents not to look like old military derelict tents, but to have the grace of the African forest. And you can't really see it on the photographs here, but the tree that's kind of wound around itself right in front is plastered with mud. I call that my eco footprint seal of approval. That's actually where elephants come and shade themselves when the camp's not there, and they bathe in the river in front of camp and come up and rub the mud up against the trees and give themselves a back rub. And I love it in camp when we see that all the trees have been plastered with mud. That means this is home to the elephants. This is a sleeping tent for twin beds. As you can see, this is camping. This is still the real deal, because our footprint is literally just what the outline of the tent is when we pull everything away. We fill in the holes for the toilets. You have running water, you have flush toilets, you have hot water showers, but it's all done by hand. This is my honeymoon tent, not my personal honeymoon tent. Honeymoon tent for others also. And we have great big double beds. And of course, as part of growing the Newland Tarlton and Company brand, I personally like to design and build furniture. We have our own Newland Tarlton and Company furniture line, which is based on Edwardian camping and campaign style furniture. So we use salvaged wood. All of the wood we use is salvaged and sustainable and handmade furniture under the Newland Tarlton & Company furniture label. Now, this is the advertising. If you go online and look up Newland Tarlton, you'll see our goal is to make furniture that's like heirloom furniture, built to last for generations, but to celebrate life in the moment. So that's our bar case, the folding computer desk, various things. Talk a bit more about, okay, so where do I live and what do I do? And let's talk a bit about the modern contemporary scene. That's my house in East Africa. It's a ranch house that was built 20 years ago on 12,000 acres. I'll show you. That's me out greeting guests. We overlook elephant herds, and leopards come and sleep right on the rocks outside the house. And this is the front entrance as you walk from the back going forward. And then the next shot shows the sweeping view of the veranda with Mount Kenya on the east. It's one of the most magnificent houses I've ever seen, and of course it's for our guests to come and stay, but it's now my home base in East Africa. I started out as a wildlife artist. My plan was to do my PhD as an archaeologist, but also sketch. I did scientific pen and ink drawings for journals. In those days we didn't have digital scanning, so I thought my career was going to go in that direction, but instead something happened with another Australian. I read a book by Alan Moorhead, the Australian writer Alan Moorhead, called The White Nile. And The White Nile, as you know, features Captain Richard Burton. I got absolutely addicted to Burton. I've spent the rest of my life studying Captain Richard Burton. I did a master's degree on the lost letters of Captain Burton. As you know, you may know, His wife burned his journals and diaries and letters when he passed away in 1890, and all of his great body of work was lost. My big project was Captain Burton's last remaining diary that was not burned by his wife. It was actually hidden away and discovered in the 60s, and I was handed that diary. I had the honor of transcribing it, publishing the search for the source of the Nile, the story of Captain Richard Burton and Lieutenant John Hanning Speke, and the controversy over the true source of the Nile. So that's Burton's actual letter diary that I was privileged to work with for about 20 years. This is Burton's tomb. Burton was the ultimate explorer, and his wife, Isabel, when he died, said, you can't just put him in a common grave. She had artisans make a model of their safari tent, carved out of Forest of Dean stone. And if you go to Mortlake, Surrey, on the opposite side of the Thames from London, and go to St. Mary's Mortlake Churchyard, you'll see Sir Richard Burton's tomb, which is a safari tent. So as I've lived my life since those formative days when I was a student there, I've copied that tent for my safari camp. That's my lounge tent today, and hanging from the front of the tent are always a camel harness festooned with brass camel bells. And I'll tell you that story just before I close my comments. So that's my, as a geographer and explorer and scholar, my study of Captain Richard Burton has been the main theme of my life for the last 30 years. I'm also a trained forensic osteologist, making research on human fossil remains. And in the 90s, I made a discovery of one of the most complete, actually it is complete, Middle Stone Age fossil skeletons in a washed out riverbed in northern Kenya. And this is when I discovered it. An elephant actually showed it to me, as it were. The night before had been one of those very bright full moons. A big bull elephant had been out watering in the river. We could hear him, and the next morning I said to my group, let's go out and follow that elephant, see what he was up to last night. He sounded upset. We followed him down the river. I found where his tracks had led. He'd actually found something and buried it. And as anybody knows, been on safari, watched the Discovery Channel, National Geographic. Elephants are some of the other mammals on this planet that understand mortality. They understand what it means. They are conscious of death. They grieve for their dead. And they have been known to bury their dead or dead other creatures, including humans. The elephant had buried something. So I said to my group, let's figure out what's under here. And as we pulled away the driftwood and palm fronds, under it I could see what during a moonlit night would have glowed. It was an opalescent fossil that had been fossilized and turned bright pearl colored. In the moonlight, it would have glowed almost neon. And the elephant saw that and buried it. And the next day I discovered that fossil because I found out where the elephant had buried it. So that skeleton is now a very important discovery. Middle Stone Age, you rarely find full skeletons from that period. We're talking, Richard Leakey dated it at about 300,000 years ago. And then the next shot shows the skeleton itself. And being a forensic osteologist, I was thrilled. It's all the bones are there, and that's my thing. Next shot shows the skull. When I first discovered it, this is the moment of the discovery. Somebody took a shot of that. So you can see the whole profile of the skeleton. We've now excavated the skeleton. It's in the National Museums of Kenya. And I hope to be able to guide a group from the museum in a couple of years, 2018, from the Waterhouse Club, from the museum, to go behind the scenes and see my fossil and others that are of importance to our human story. My PhD subject was a study of the comparison of Maasai people and their use of wildlife in their iconography and their religions, and the comparison to the Plains Indians of North America. I got distracted, sidetracked, I started guiding safaris. I never got back to it until now. The people of East Africa I can't neglect because they are as fascinating and as vibrant and as exciting. The next few pictures, my friends Angela and Carol are the authorities These are just shots that I've taken over the years of Samburu people, Maasai people, and I've even had some of my guests come out and decide to get married and have a Maasai wedding ceremony. This is one of my best friends and my research partner, William Kimisop, who's the senior warden of the Northern Rift Valley. That's Lake Turkana, Lake Nakuru, Baringo, Bogoria, that area. Together, William and I have been researching a phenomena that I heard about when I was doing my PhD preliminary work about the elephant singers, men who believe and who seem to be able to communicate with elephants through ritual song. So my lecture a month ago at the Explorers Club was the first time I have talked in public about the research William and I are doing about the elephant singers of the Kerio Valley in western Kenya, west of Lake Bogoria. This is one of the elephant singers. He's demonstrating. He's not singing the aria from Tosca. He's demonstrating one of the songs he sings to elephants. I've never actually seen an elephant singer in the context of what they do with elephants. That's obviously such a sensitive thing, than such a rare thing. But here he is singing one of his songs, and I happened to photograph an elephant who wasn't listening to him. But it's exactly how it would react. It's meant to be. The elephant represents what is the best of the humankind. The biggest compliment you can pay to someone, you've got the soul of an elephant. You have kindness and strength and goodness and wisdom. And elephants are the epitome of good. It's not in a religious context like Buddha or Jesus or whomever. It's the elephant represents the goodness. To this day, they teach children, grow up and be like the elephant. Be strong but gentle. Be wise and caring. I love that. This is Benjamin Sawe, my friend William and I, interviewing Benjamin. There's books and books that could be written about the relationship between elephants and the Kerio people, the Tugan and the Marakwet, Elgeyo Marakwet people. Next shot shows the elephants actually in the Kerio Valley, and I'm happy to say, thanks to the work William and I have done, we've just had this declared a national park. We've just had, I designed a series of areas where people can come and see the elephants, and it's now up and running. So we're starting to use this philosophy to help protect the elephants in that area. So what's even more important to me is in the next shot, this is the grandfather blessing his grandson, this is Benjamin Sawe blessing Emmanuel, to become a new elephant singer. This is the key to Africa and the modern era. It has to be an investment of the traditional people, the African people themselves. The number one cause of the death of wildlife is habitat destruction and human use of land resources and crowding out the animals and killing them off. In the next couple of shots, the wildebeest, the most famous event in East Africa, one of the great tourist attractions, in fact, the single most important wildlife event, is the next series of shots, are tens of thousands of wildebeest coming into Kenya in the Maasai Mara during July, August, and September. I've watched every one since 1977. This is what you see. Crocs are waiting for the wildebeest to cross. You've all seen better shots than this in movies on television, but these are my own pictures. Next. I'm particularly involved with lion conservation. We've watched lion numbers plummet by the tens and thousands in the last 30 years. We don't even know how few lions are left right now. We're trying to do a census. I've been involved for the last several years in something called the Lion Guardians Program. It's going back into communities where lions and people have to live side by side, helping people to recognize the value of lions economically, for tourism, for jobs, to bring attention to their community. So in the next couple of shots, these are lions that are part of my community. Obviously, lions are very reproductive. They can have six cubs at once. Under ideal circumstances, they overpopulate an area very fast. This is one of the first photographs I ever took. When I first went to East Africa in 1977, I took this with one of these old Leica cameras. It's still one of my favorite pictures. The next picture is critical that I show you. This guy is part of the Marsh Pride, probably the single most famous lion pride in East Africa. That's at the base of Kichwa Tembo. Opposite there is, they filmed out of Africa up on the top. They have Governor's Camp, one of the earliest tourist lodges. He was one of the most famous lions in the world. Last year, he was murdered. The Maasai have been illegally driving their cattle down at night and feeding them on that grassland. One of the cows died, the lions were feeding on it. The owner of the Maasai went in and put furadan, an illegal poison, on the carcass, wiped out the entire marsh pride overnight. Within the next few days, lions died agonizing deaths. My colleagues and I all saw them out, foaming at the mouth, curled up in agony. We wept with distress, anger, and shame that the human race was doing this. The young Maasai herders who got busted for doing it were in prison for a few days and got let off. There's absolutely no real legal strength to doing that sort of act. You can't bust people. You have to have them care about lions and them be invested in lions' future. How do you do that? In lion, so that's RIP, that lion. Two women, Dr. Leela Hazah, Dr. Stephanie Dolrenry, started a program called Lion Guardians. They take Maasai warriors who are trained from boyhood to kill lions as part of their rituals of manhood, and instead teaches them to track lions and study lions, understand lions, name lions, become involved with the lions in their area. Lion Guardians has become the single most effective conservation tool for predators in history. We now have a situation where we've financed to have lion facial recognition software that you can download on your cell phone. You can be out on safari, take a cell phone picture of a lion, upload it, and have us get our database. We've got tens of thousands of images. We can now trace lions visually through different parts of East Africa, find out about their movements, their affinities, their relationships with each lion group. So these are critical things. The elephant singers and lion guardians are the secret of stopping the murder of Africa's wildlife and saving the populations of animals that I showed you at the beginning of this slideshow. Cheetahs are dying from poisoning. They're being kidnapped. There's a huge market in the Arab Emirates for pet cheetahs, and people are being paid off to go in at night and dart cheetahs, smuggle them out of the country. People at the airports are being paid off. Cheetahs are being taken out as live captives and taken out to Dubai and Qatar and places like that for private zoos. Wild cheetahs are vulnerable to all kinds of pressure from humans. Often human herd boys will see a cheetah on a kill, they'll chase the cheetah off and roast up the meat or feed it to their dogs. Cheetahs get harassed, and of course the cheetahs, once animals move in and chase away the wildlife, have nothing to eat. So we've got to continue to monitor and find ways to support community-based conservation. A cheetah is a fantastic animal. It's very vulnerable. It's so inbred now because of the dwindling populations that any virus could come in and wipe out all the cheetahs. Rhinos, of course, because of rhino horn, have been decimated, and the only rhinos left alive now are in private ranches. 24-hour guards are required, and even then we're losing rhinos. To see a wild rhino like this in his own habitat is such an exciting pleasure. This is on Lewa Downs Rhino Sanctuary in northern Kenya. So I wanted to bring you up to date. I wanted, first of all, to have you aware that your hometown, Adelaide, has done its job in creating the wildlife safaris as we know them today through Victor Mara Newland, Leslie Tarlton. I've tried to give you some ideas about some of the challenges we face, but East Africa is still a fabulous destination. Wildlife, I think we can turn the corner with programs like Lion Guardians. We can make a place for wildlife on the planet. So I would like to say that your grandchildren at home might be able to look forward to seeing the view you'll see now. African sunset, the wide open plains, giraffe, elephants, living wild and free in the plains that I've called home for the last nearly, 40 years. Thank you very much.